and welcome to the work session for the Board of Mayor and Aldermen for April 24th, 2018. And we're going to start out with an opportunity for citizens to make comments that are not on the agenda. So I have a lot of speaker cards that are for an item on the agenda, and we'll hold those until that item comes up. So we'll move on to item one, which is the Development Services Quarterly Activity Report, including the use of the online inspection scheduling portal and service commitments.
Good morning, or good morning, good
evening.
I don't even know where I am.
Good evening, Mayor and Alderman. Lynn Osland is with us. Lynn is our Development Services Analyst, does great work in looking at our process and data related to development in the community. One of the things we've been doing for the last several quarters is bring to you quarterly information about permitted development. Lynn's going to do that today, but she's also going to give you some other information about how we're working with the public and with our customers in terms of scheduling things like inspections and our commitment in terms of time frames and turnarounds with the work that we do with the public and with folks that are working on development in Franklin. So Lynn, take it away.
Thank you. Well, I know by now you've seen these quarterly reports. So as I reviewed the one that I'm presenting tonight, I was looking for some trends and went back several years to see which quarters were maybe the most active, if there was anything consistent, like the first quarter's great, you know. Anyway, I could not find a trend. Each year and each quarter is just so different that there's no predicting. I did note that our first quarter of 2018, we issued 1,581 permits, which is very close to what we issued in the last quarter of 2017, which was 1,504 permits. So we're really going along very steady. I also took a look at single family and townhome building permits, and we issued the first quarter of this year 163 permits for those two types of dwellings. And the last quarter of 2017, we issued 122. So we were up a bit on that. One of the most interesting things that I came across for this quarter was that our estimated valuation of building permits, or what we refer to as our investment in our community, was for first quarter of 2018, $174,136,000. That's quite a bit less than what we saw the last quarter of 2017, which was an exceptionally busy quarter. But I did take an average to see how we did from 2015 through 2017. So those 3 years and quarters, the average was $171,703,000. So we were almost right on the average for the first quarter of 2018. So our work remains steady, and I will report back next quarter as far as that goes. Any questions on this report?
Okay.
All right.
Keep going.
All right. The next item I wanted to talk about is something that we have implemented over the last several years and continuing to make better for our applicants and citizens in the building department is the online inspection portal. We have gone from 67% of inspections scheduled online in 2016, and in 2018, we're up to 83.98% scheduled online. There are several advantages to scheduling online. First of all, previously, you would have to phone in your information. A lot of times, the information might not make it through the call, such as building permit number or the location. There's just a lot of information that didn't quite get communicated. But the major disadvantage to doing it on the phone is you must call by 12 p.m. for a next day inspection. a lot of times contractors don't know if their work is going to be completed at that time of day for a next day inspection. Well, once we've implemented the online inspection scheduling, you can schedule an inspection as late as 5:30 a.m. and receive a same day inspection. So you can be in your pajamas and schedule your inspection for later that day, and all works out well. The online inspection portal is quite easy to get to. On our website, across the top, there are those buttons, and you can push the I want to button. And in the drop down, there's request an inspection. And then once you go through that, it will walk you through how to do it. You initially have to set up an account, but after that, it works out very easily every day. So we have an average of 90 inspections scheduled per day online versus 16 scheduled by phone now. The other items that I wanted to talk about, you might see these signs in the back of the room. These are typically the banners that stand outside of our Building and Neighborhood Services Department. These are the service commitments or the time frames that we commit to in order to provide a better, more predictable experience for our citizens. And the banner on the right has to do with our plan review times, and it varies between non-residential and residential, and then other types of reviews as well. Again, it addresses inspection requests, and in addition to construction inspection, we have the zoning inspections, beer board inspections, and certificate of occupancy inspections. And then, of course, letters and permits through our zoning department regarding zoning and floodplain, etc. Service requests are down at the bottom, and that's very similar to requesting an inspection. You can go to the I want to and press the service or submit a service request area from that. And also, if you want to request public records, you can use the same area from our website, I want to, and then go to request a public record.
Lynn, excuse me.
Yes.
When you have turnaround?
Yes.
Is that assuming that everything's in order and everything, they don't have to go back for anything?
Well, on occasion, if you'll see that we also have the third item down is resubmittals. So if there are problems, the first review, and these are for the non-residential projects, is 20 days. And then the applicant will receive comments, if there are, or an approval letter at that time. And then once they resubmit, then they will have another 10-day turnaround if a resubmittal is necessary.
Okay.
But we really strive to reach these time frames 100% of the time, and we do quite well.
Thank you.
Sure. And so the other banner summarizes our One Stop, which you may have heard about. That is a process where we have our doors open on Mondays and Wednesdays from 9 a.m. until 11 a.m. And that's where anyone can walk in and meet with our staff. We have everyone gathered that day and they're available. You can also request a building permit, and oftentimes we will issue one on that day. We average about 68% of building permits are approved through our One Stop, or I guess I should say 68% of the applications that come through our One Stop are approved. And the other 32% aren't necessarily failed, it's just that then they will be brought in to our normal workflow. Maybe they need a little bit more information or whatever, but the One Stop provides an added layer for the applicants to discuss their items actually with the plans examiners or get other information that they might not necessarily get by just purely submitting online and not having a face-to-face. We also, on the first and third Wednesdays, offer land development applications. That would be site plans and final plats and some development plans, where we gather all of our development services team. So in addition to the building and neighborhood services, we have our engineering, planning, water, wastewater, et cetera, fire, all of those people in one place so that we can review those plans as well. So in the first quarter of 2018, we have taken a look, processed, or met on 262 projects at our one stop, compared to in 2017, we processed 2,078 plans at our one stop. So it's really become a busy time for us and a very beneficial time as well.
Is it getting any better?
The building permit section is, we're working on ways to improve our development plans, final plats and site plans. We've had a little bit of a dip as far as approvals go, but we're working on better communication and better plans. That's something that we're, one of the first items we're going to take a look at when we appoint our development services advisory team. Get some information.
But see, not much change from several months ago to right now.
Not right now.
And FYI, on the commission that you mentioned, we have over 30 applicants, and so we're going to pick a date that I'll sit down with staff and start to go through those and try to pick some appointments.
But Lynn's highlighted some key performance things. When you look big picture, 70% of these projects roughly are coming through and being able to approved at one stop. So they're able to walk out with the permit they need to do their work. So that's a huge improvement over the processes we had a few years ago. You also look at that time, we also had everyone scheduling by calling in, and that had its issues, and now 85% of them are doing it online and are able to schedule either next day or same day inspections on their work. So we think we've enhanced responsiveness, but we've also managed to maintain and build a further focus on quality. And the things that don't make the cut on one stop, we examine what that is and what's causing additional review and provide that feedback. And hopefully, that's one of the things Lynn helps us do is hone in on where the process is working well, where we're seeing deficiencies, and how we can work together to address them. So I think it's really a positive about the way we have handled it, really an unprecedented workload, but managed to find ways to improve service level, but still stay focused on quality.
We'll go to event permit for Derby Day. Any questions on that one? Next would be pilgrimage, long-term special event permit.
So item three is a follow-up. You may remember a few meetings ago we approved a permit for pilgrimage, and we also talked about their eligibility for a long-term permit. The action you took that night actually just approved the permit for 2018. What we're providing for you tonight is a long-term permit, which is the five-year window. They've met the specific elements that the board set out in the ordinance to allow for multi-year permitting. While that multi-year permit is provided, there is still an annual review and annual approval that takes place. So it really doesn't take away from the review that happens from the submission by the applicant, by the review from the special events committee, which is representative of really all of our city departments, and then coming to you with what this year's event's gonna look like. So you're still gonna see it every year like you're accustomed to, but it provides a longer term framework and commitment so that the event organizers for these large events can plan and invest with that in mind. So this really just provides that for you, and they've provided the information necessary to meet those guidelines.
So yeah, my question would be, I guess, are there protections, are there certain if we had a non-music board in 8 years, that they couldn't just cancel it. There's certain maybe things in the contract that they'd have to violate in order for them to not come through. Obviously, they're going to have some long-term contracts.
Well, you've got that long-term planning commitment, but you still have an annual review, and you can take action based on the will of the board about that individual year's event as well. So you've really got an approval for a longer-term framework, but you're still approving the annual event. Because each year's event has a little tweak to it.
Should there be some protections in there for the organizer? I mean, they probably have some multiple year outlays, I guess.
Yeah. Well,
they didn't have enough jazz for Alderman Martin. And,
yeah, this is part of the balance that we tried to strike in writing it, that it was important to still have that annual review and for that organizer to submit that year's plan. Because each year, from doing these, each year has a little wrinkle to it.
Sure.
And we want to make sure that those are clear and clearly described and give you an opportunity to weigh in on it. Now, I'm certain that if we reached a point where the board wasn't happy with an event, there would be some dialogue about what could be adjusted and how it could still fit within that longer term commitment. But I think that's important to provide that accountability for this board and to the community.
Well, this basically just ties up a specific weekend for 5 years.
It really helps us with the scheduling. In a lot of ways, it's what we already have done for many years. You look at the next item, which is Main Street Festival. We plan in a way that we know when they're going to be scheduled. We sort of protect those dates. But this gives us a more specific framework to protect those dates and those locations for specific events so that something doesn't get scheduled over it or interfere with it. And they're large-scale enough events that we want to provide that kind of certainty around scheduling the space.
Well, I think the event promoters understood our concerns from the last meeting that we had. I'm hoping that's been discussed at some point in time in some committee level other than this committee here, mm-hmm. because there were several issues. Mm-hmm. And certainly some of them were parking and all the other issues that we had. So
absolutely.
Here's Monique. Yeah,
Monique can talk about it. Yeah. We some of those were addressed during the event.
Yeah.
Saturday to Sunday were different experiences on parking in particular. There were a debrief always happens with every event. We also are planning to do a tabletop exercise. Next Wednesday, yeah. It's on my schedule. And we're doing that with the pilgrimage organizers to sort of plan out scenarios and responses to different events that can happen at an event of this scale. So with our city team, and so there's a lot of planning and there's an ever-present feedback loop that's
there
going
is.
On.
There is. Even before the board meeting, we had talked to them about the issues, and some of them they were able to correct on Sunday, and some of them they know they'll need to correct in the future. So we're in ongoing dialogue with them constantly about, you know, improving and, you know, doing the things that we expect them to do.
And we look at ourselves in terms of where we want staff and need staff support on certain mm-hmm. elements. And so it's what city resources can do to help make events as successful and safe as possible, as well as what those event organizers need to do to help make the event successful.
But parking, lighting, all of those we've looked at.
We have, yes, sir. Very extensively.
Alderman Martin, you want to make a comment about jazz?
Easy listening, I think.
Easy listening.
Easy listening.
I hadn't heard a thing about easy listening. All right.
Not that crazy jazz stuff.
I just want to be sure to piggyback off of Clyde's remarks that things like running out of water, mm-hmm. those things are addressed. And does that come to you? Because we don't ever hear another word about this.
Yeah, it comes to our special events advisory team.
Until the event's over.
Right. they've met probably already 3 times with our special events advisory team, and we're meeting next week, and we'll meet several times before September, and, you know, they'll know what they need to do and what our expectations are.
Because there were some pretty heavy issues.
There were. Okay. And, you know, we've been told they'll be corrected, so we expect them to be.
Thank you.
Alderman Glenn.
I've said in the past kind of how I feel about this, and I am not at all anti-pilgrimage, but I think there's a clear distinction between a Main Street Festival and a Pumpkin Fest and things that have gone on for decades. And I'm not at all saying, I understand, like you're saying, the idea of planning far in advance. I just think we need to really hold the hand, because there's a lot of people this affects, much like a Main Street, which is happening this weekend, where 150,000 people are estimated to descend upon our Main Street and the 16 blocks and beyond. And I just think we've got to make sure that we can answer the questions for the citizen who their quality of life is disrupted,
right,
and who doesn't really care to participate in pilgrimage.
Right. And that's
so
what our
again,
team...
I sound like I'm like against it. I'm not, and I wish Kevin and Brant were here to hear me say that, but we're the ones that get the, I just pack up my house and go out of town because I live on Miles Manor, and I can't combat it. That's the kind of stuff I'm going, God, I hate that. Or I own a business on Franklin Road, and it's prom night, and I have two weddings, and I can't access my flower shop. So those are the things that I hear that make me feel like, I just want to make sure, and I know that you do an incredible job, Monique, and I know that we have a committee set up that goes through every fine detail of this, and I also know it's something new. It's a new venue, it's a new event, even though we're going into year four, but I just want to make sure that we really, as much as it's wonderful and it's great to have the hits and the media attention, our job is to take care of the people who pay taxes to live here and call this home.
And that's what our team keeps in mind. You know, we're here for our residents. We want to have a safe event, but we also want to inconvenience our residents as much as possible.
I think it's great. I think we've got to have
not inconveniencing.
And we're still figuring it out. I know that.
And one of the things, you talked a number of examples about access. And we have police officers out on Franklin Road in particular, and one of the things they're focused on is access for every resident and every business. And part of their job is to make sure nobody's cut off. It may not be as convenient as normal or as you'd like.
And we've been in some of those situations.
But yes,
you and I
talk. Yes.
I'm just trying to paint a picture. I'm not trying to say it wasn't taken care of, but there's things that come up that we hear that Monique may never know about, or Brant may never know about, or Kevin, or Glenn Johnson, because they see us as the one that they've got to complain to.
Right, absolutely.
So.
Okay, item four is Main Street Festival multi-year agreement. Then we have items 5, 6, 7, 8, and 9 have to do with renewal for wine and grocery stores. Everybody good with those? Then number 10 is a resolution 2018-20 to award the FY 2019 on-call annual contract for pavement preservation.
In this item, this title may not totally describe what we're talking about, which is really the sealing program that we've implemented for neighborhood streets. It's a way for us to prolong the life of some of our neighborhood streets, especially at a certain stage in their life. We can do this sealing, and it helps us prolong and defer our need to go ahead and do a resurfacing. So this is something that Joe and the streets team brought to us in budget last year. We've done a few pilot projects in some neighborhoods, and this helps us spend the balance of that money this year. So.
And of course, Jared Builders was the low bidder. They were also the contractor that implemented the seal in Golden Meadows. We were very pleased with that. And we would be appreciative if you award this bid.
So it has nothing to do really with repaving?
No, it's sealing.
Sealing.
It's the sealing on top
seal
of...
Seal preservation.
Yeah.
So who does the paving for us now? Tennessee Valley?
Tennessee Valley. But okay. We're rebidding that this year also. So they've had it for years, though.
Yes.
And but this seal, we can do a third, or should I say, three times as many streets with the seal as we can with milling and resurfacing. And that prolongs the life for another 6 to 7 years, and then it's possible we can reseal again and prolong the life. It, because sealing and, milling and resurfacing costs a lot of money, and it takes a lot of supplies to do that. So this seal, we're looking forward to using that. We have money in the contract or in the budget this year to do this.
Is this new? Is this something?
It's not new. Seal has been around for a long time.
Well, why haven't we been using it?
Because these two products that we intend to use, the liquids road and HA5, are fairly new products. We have never been pleased with the products that other cities have used because they just don't last. we are convinced that these two products will last us for a number of years.
It's more of a comment, Joe. It's just that it seemed like the quality of the asphalt is not like it used to be. What are they using?
The contractors will tell you the oil is not as good as it used to be.
Because if it's crumbling, the seal that you're talking about is going to be more important to have that done to streets. Because if we're dealing with a different quality of the
Quality of asphalt.
Yeah.
The asphalt just doesn't last as long as it used to. You're absolutely right. We used to expect 15 to 20 years out of the asphalt. Now it's more like 10 or 12. So.
Joe, can you tell me, I've had a couple calls about some of the spots in the road, and a great example that I can think of right now, it's not in my ward, but if you're going up Columbia Avenue, or south on Columbia Avenue, and you get to Matt Hatcher, right before you get to the light, I don't know if it's been fixed, but it's rumbly, you know, it feels like an earthquake had gone over there and you left the pavement like this. What's causing that, and can you fix that with this method, or does it?
No. Seal won't help that.
You can't smooth it out and then seal it back.
The seal works on streets that have been resurfaced in the last 5 to 10 years. Okay. Now, our pilot project to ensure that we were really going to move forward, or wanted to move forward with this, Golden Meadows. Golden Meadows was paved probably 15, 16 years ago, and has never been resurfaced. And so far, we are still pleased with the seal that we put on that road. And if it prolongs the life of that street for another 6 or 7 years, we really got our money's worth.
Kent, what is causing that effect?
A lot of traffic, heavy trucks, concrete trucks, dump trucks.
Some fellows told me, he used to work in this industry, and he said that originally was not put down properly to cause that. And I said, I don't know. Not in that industry. I don't know.
That's T-Dot.
If you remember, a few years ago, we implemented T-Dot concrete at a couple of intersections on Downs Boulevard because asphalt would just not hold up. Mm-hmm. The trucks stopping.
The way it pushes us.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Like Royal Oaks is the same way. For a little bit.
And we hope to start milling and resurfacing it tomorrow.
Cool.
But the concrete seal doesn't fail.
Concrete is holding up, but it's very expensive.
It's more expensive to do, but do it in the right places, it can help, especially with intersections.
Where's Golden Meadows?
Liberty Pike.
Off of Liberty.
Yeah, it's
the second subdivision coming in.
Right before you get to Mack Hatcher, a couple.
Between Mallory and Mack Hatcher.
You got to get out more.
Apparently not in your ward.
You got to get out a little bit more.
We're going to have a jazz festival on the street.
Okay, so we'll see what this does, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
And we do have money left in the budget to implement this.
How about number 11? Request to deny sanitary sewer availability on 841 Old Charlotte Pike East, and we'll talk about the denial also on Columbia Pike, if that's okay. Can you do both of those at once?
We can do both of them at once.
They're kind of different, though, aren't they?
They are a little bit different.
Yeah, go ahead and walk through them.
The 841 Old Charlotte Pike is a single-family house. They're putting some type of equestrian facility over there. It's in our urban growth boundary, but outside our city limits. Sewer is there. There's a pump station there to serve it. It's about 1,000 feet from the property line. In the past, the board has essentially approved the denial of these types of requests, so that's what we're recommending. That's what the property owner wants, and it's only one single-family equivalent. Any questions?
The property owner is in agreement.
Yes, this is at their request. We could.
Well, this is real that they have to come to us before they can get the building permit from the county.
The county won't allow it unless we do.
Deny.
Since it's in our area.
And number 12,
next. Next one is off of Columbia Pike, and essentially the infrastructure is about 8,000 linear feet from its property line. It would require a pump station and a pretty extensive off-site force main to serve it. It's in a totally different basin that doesn't have any sewer infrastructure. They're wanting to move forward with the development, and we're recommending the denial of the sanitary sewer at their request.
But this is, how many gallons per day is it going to use, though? I mean, it's definitely different.
I have to look at it real quick.
It says 160
16,000 gallons per day.
Yeah, and I was going to say, it's very possible that the soil out there is fine to.
As they stated, they've already gone through the county process. They didn't come to us. They went through the county process to do
great.
The testing.
So they're great. Able. Okay.
So it'll park.
Yes.
That
exactly.
That's a pretty lengthy distance for the.
Yeah, no. Yes. From our
that would really be.
Yeah, and the pump station.
And
it's pretty cost prohibitive.
Topography, yeah.
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 It's not like, as you say, it's not in the basin.
Are they required to have more than one site, a perk site?
They'll be required to have usually two types of systems out there, a backup field and a primary field, mm-hmm. is mm-hmm. my understanding of the county
usually
regulations.
Usually they do, but.
Yeah.
Right. But the soil kind of south of downtown is a lot different from the soil north of downtown.
Right.
Okay. Any other questions
it's
on this
rocking,
one? Ready to move
works.
On to 13, which is amendment to the professional services agreement with Sullivan Engineering for the final design of the East McEwen Drive Phase 4 improvements in an amount not to exceed $255,500.
So basically where we're at with the plans now is we're finishing up the NEPA phase. We're very close to getting that approval. What we've been working on over the last 2 months with our consultant is some utility coordination. And some of the roadway, we're doing 20-foot cuts in certain locations, and you have to keep those utilities live during that time frame. And so we're at a point now where we either need to pay the utility company and enter into agreements with them to do the design and relocation plans, or we can pay our consultant to do the majority of that. So in an effort to try to expedite the project, and our consultant understands the plans, they understand the limitations, they have the survey, we want our consultant to do the design. So they'll design the sanitary sewer force main, they're going to design the Millcroft and water line, and then we're going to provide alignments to Atmos Gas, who's got a major transmission main that runs through there, and provide alignments to Middle Tennessee Electric. And so instead of paying the utility companies, we prefer to pay our consultant because we think we can deliver it faster. The reason we're bringing this forward now is because once we complete NEPA, we need to go out and acquire easements. For the most part, the city's going to have to acquire these easements on behalf of the utility companies. And so we're trying to get the utilities finalized so that the second we get that environmental approval, we can go out and start appraising property and acquiring the property. So there's an extensive amount of work to do to get to that point, and we're trying to push it through as fast as we can at this point.
Alderman Berger, I think that's your ward, isn't it?
Hallelujah. Can you tell me, remind me again, this is the consultant. Thank you for hiring a consultant, by the way. Thank you, because that will really help. Is that the consultants, they're going to secure both the temporary and long-term easements?
Yes, part of the design plans, we'll get all the temporary and long-term easements that we need and all the right
permanent.
Away. Permanent.
I don't mean long-term, I mean permanent. Temporary
yep.
and permanent.
They're going to identify all those for us.
So, okay.
And then we'll go out and acquire them as soon as it's finalized and
okay.
the utility sign off on it.
So do you see us going for the right-of-way by the end of summer or September, maybe?
I see us starting the appraisal process by then, if not making offers. My goal is to be making offers before that. But a lot of it's going to come down to getting these utility companies to sign off
mm-hmm.
on. And
mm-hmm.
Our consultants already started work on that, which we really appreciate them doing that. But we needed to get this contract figured out so that we could actually pay them to do that. And it's a very difficult job given the large cuts we're doing and the utilities that are in those cut areas.
It takes a long time.
It's complicated.
All right. So will you get reports back from the consultant from time to time so we will know how they're doing with getting these securing easements?
Yeah, at this point we're meeting every week, and we cancel them on occasion when we don't have a lot to talk about, but we're basically meeting weekly to look at the utility alignments and make sure we're in agreement. And once they basically have them at a point now where we got to start meeting with the utility companies to get their blessing, which is what we're working on over the next hopefully 2 to 3 weeks to get their approvals. From that point, we can finalize it and then be ready to acquire right away.
So is this the final design?
It
dollar
is,
spin for the design?
It is. I mean, we've said that a few times, but then we ran into these utility conflicts. There may be one more amendment. It just depends once we make a plan submittal to TDOT. The plans were done without the TDOT contract in place, so everything might not be perfectly to TDOT standard. but we're going to wait to make the submittal to TDOT and see if they're requesting additional information. For example, TDOT may require you to do borings every 50 feet, and we took them out every 100 feet.
Yeah.
And so there may be some type of requirement like that. We've tried to proactively include what we needed to in this scope to try to avoid that,
yeah.
But it's always an unknown when you submit to another agency what kind of comments are going to come back with. And so depending on how that goes, we may have to amend the contract again.
So this final may not be final.
It may not be final.
Okay,
we
just want to make sure our public know that.
We hope it is.
More final than it was.
We have to spend those dollars.
Yeah. Okay.
Thank you.
Item number 14, Resolution 2018-28, authorizing directing the Industrial Development Board of the City of Franklin to prepay a portion of its taxable
rate.
I wanted to say variable. Our taxable rate tax increment revenue refunding bonds.
This is an item we brought before the Budget and Finance Committee last week or a week or so ago, and I wanted to have Christine walk through it with the full board. This is basically where we are today with the tax increment financing district that was created, sometimes called the Nissan TIF, but it is a TIF district that is roughly around the McEwen I-65 interchange, roughly a mile radius around that area. And all development that has happened in that area, and yes, it did facilitate Nissan coming to our community, but all development in that area contributes to pay off bonds that were issued on behalf of that district. And initially, it did not produce enough to fill its obligation. That has changed over time. We're now in a place where it's more than meeting its obligation, and we want to get the board's direction on how to handle that revenue above what this year's requirement is. And that's what Christine is going to walk through for you with our recommendation.
Thank you. This is the second year that we staff has presented to the board a proposal to prepay a portion of the 2015 refunding bonds. They were originally issued in 2005 and refunded in 2015. And this is the same format that we presented in an informational setting last year, and we want to walk through that with you again. As we currently, of course, we have not closed out fiscal year 2018, but property taxes are essentially collected by the county trustee. And this is a little better year to give you a feeling for what the assessed value within the district, which is our taxable base within the district, looks like in growth year over year. Between fiscal year 17, fiscal year 18, we had 8.9% or $39.2 million of increase in the assessed valuation. You'll recall that the year prior, 2016, was a reassessment year. So not only was there some natural growth, but there also was reassessment when the county did its countywide reappraisal. That year was over a 50% assessment growth in the district. So 2018 gives us a little better sense of the valuation growth within the district itself. It only stands to reason if we have just under 9% increase in our taxable base that our tax revenues increased a similar amount, 8.9% from 17 to 18. We did cross the $2 million amount for billing within the district. We just at $2,003,609. That was our property tax billings for 2018. A summary of the financial results for the district. We start with our property taxes that were billed. At this point, while certainly there are some stragglers coming in paying their property taxes, essentially the county trustee has collected, I estimate 3% for uncollectibles at this present time. And she will eventually, of course, through her procedures, collect essentially all the property taxes. But for purposes of this exercise, I'll assume 3% to have a property taxes net of uncollected taxes of $1,943,501. We do have principal and interest that was paid in fiscal year 2018 of $1.3 million, which leaves net property taxes less debt service expense of $627,520. The recommendation that we brought to you last year was to essentially prepay the 2015 bonds first, and we, as Eric alluded to, we do have monies to repay ourselves, repay our general fund. It's about $2.5 million. We do have increments that we can repay debt with early. We can't put an odd amount to debt repayment. But last year, you'll recall that we did prepay $700,000, and we prepay that from the very back of the amortization. So we'll just essentially move up when the final maturity of those bonds will be. This year, we did have it scheduled to pay more principal, so we had a little bit more debt service, about $300,000 more in debt service that was scheduled for 2018. So we have, even though revenues did grow, we do have more debt service expense. So we're recommending that we prepay $600,000 toward the 2015 bonds. Those will be all paying off the variable rate, which the backside of those 2015 bonds was variable rate. What we've been repaying right now in our regular amortization is fixed rate bonds. So we'll prepay on the backside, and that would leave us at the end of this fiscal year of an outstanding balance on the 2015 bonds of $7,785,236. To give you a sense of what the remaining debt service looks like with the 2015 bonds, we do with this prepayment, we would be able to actually pull back into the last principal payment would be at the very end of calendar year 24, which is the first half of fiscal year 25. So you can kind of see that stair step now on 2025 is it looks about half to a little less than half of what the debt service is due on the earlier years, which was essentially a level debt service. So that's where the prepayment on the back end is taken into account, pulling back that structure so that we can and essentially repay these bonds earlier than what the final maturity.
Do we anticipate this happening again and again?
Every year.
Yeah. And last year, since this was the first year, we...
This isn't my gift, it's...
and last year was really the year to learn what all the steps would look like. It was the first year to have additional funds to be able to repay. So this year, we're a little bit more mechanical in how we can approach that. But certainly, we would anticipate that we'll be able to make a presentation every year to be able to step back. And that's where this slide here is to give a little indication of certainly want to be conservative in what estimates we have for future growth in the tax increment financing district. But we believe it's likely, probably on the conservative side, but it's likely that we'll be paying those bonds off in full in 2022. But we will essentially still need to repay ourselves back and keep the district in place until 2023. And that's a fairly conservative view, but we believe that that's reasonable at this time, that we would continue to stair step back and be able to repay those bonds in 2022.
So once you've repaid those bonds, this becomes a general fund revenue source that we're not seeing today. So that's a positive for us in terms of the long-term payoff of growth and development in that area. And that's essentially, from a policy standpoint, why you do a TIF district. It facilitates investment that otherwise might not happen and then long-term benefits the community and our taxpayers. So you're seeing that happen right here. As Christine said, we're paying off now from the back end forward. We're able to retire especially variable rate debt, which is good too, because there's an exposure about what those rates could be over time. So this is a strong statement about the success of that district and where we are financially with it. And this trend is a good one. So we're glad to present it to you.
It's an extremely good one.
Yes.
And certainly, as we pointed out to the Budget and Finance Committee when we spoke to them, that this repayment scenario fits in nicely with our overall debt structure for the general fund, that we have actually our highest year for debt service is 2024. And it's about $1.5 million step up. And we step up in debt service and we start backing down, but it does fit nicely into being able to accomplish the debt service structure that's in 2024. And then we would be able to use that for that purpose if that it's such that the will, but it does fit pretty nicely into that timing.
What is you know about off the top of your head what the interest rate is on the variable portion?
It's set up as a LIBOR plus 75 basis points, and when we were here last year, we were talking about 1.8%.
Yeah.
Now we're talking about 2.6, mm-hmm. and so. We certainly are. We've had about a 1% increase overall And actually, we were with you last August doing this similar presentation, so that's really been less than 12 months mm-hmm. that we've seen that type of increase.
All the more reason to be able to pay off the variable
rate. That's right.
Absolutely.
It's a good thing.
Yes, ma'am. We do come back to you with the same steps for this allocation of 2018 property taxes. There is a one-page resolution similar to what you adopted last year, which directs staff and the bank, BB&T, and as well as through our trustee bank to repay the $600,000. We do have administrative approvals with the Industrial Development Board. Mm-hmm. Staff handles the rest of the process. This is the approval, consideration and approval of the resolution is the board action that's required to reduce the loan amount.
Questions? Everybody clear? Ready to move on? Item 15, consideration of City of Franklin contract 2018-0057, engagement agreement with Miller and Martin for outside council services for right-of-way and slope easements on Lewisburg Pike.
So this is legal services to help us with some property that's needed for public access in that area along Lewisburg.
Okay. May I ask a question?
Absolutely, Alderman Martin.
I don't have a problem with the legal document. I just want to know where the property is on Lewisburg Pike.
Thank you, same thing.
You know where Stream Valley development is uh-huh. and yeah. the southern part of Franklin along Lewisburg, it's that area.
Okay.
And in particular, this would help us with that second southern access into that neighborhood and in that area.
I just couldn't. This was all about the document and not about the property.
There's not a map, but yeah, it's in that area.
And the reason we're doing it through Doug is because it's a state route, and Doug can have attorney general privileges because he was an attorney general before, and that allows us to use condemnation and speed up the process by using him rather than go through the state. Otherwise, we would do it, but it's a state road, so we have to use special processes.
Gives him something to do.
I think he has enough to do. But
he's always willing to help.
Don't let that be in the record.
That's right. Thank you.
Oh, it's in the record.
Alderman, Vice Mayor.
Sorry. Thank you. I appreciate your asking. I was going to ask it.
Moving on to 16 very quickly. consideration of submitting correspondence to the Tennessee Department of Transportation waiving the city's rights to purchase excess TDOT right-of-way known as a segment of Riverside Drive.
So Vernon will take us through this.
Tell us about this.
First of all, just to orient you to the illustration that's up on the screen, we're talking about the property behind the Home Depot and I-65. Werner Bass had developed a lot of that area. He has recently partnered with Bob Goodall to form Franklin Investment Holding, and they're contemplating developing the property. They're in the very preliminary stages, and want to start meeting with residents and talking about the future use of that property. As they've started to look at it, you'll notice that on the right side of the screen, there's the Riverside Drive owned by TDOT. It's not Riverside Drive, there's a partial road there, but they have contacted TDOT, being Werner Bass and Bob Goodall, and asked if they can purchase that. In preliminary discussions with TDOT, TDOT has indicated a willingness to have their access land committee consider selling that property to the investment holding company. As part of the access lands committee process, they asked the city, the jurisdiction and where it is, if they're interested in purchasing it. We've talked amongst our team and with Mr. Goodall and Mr. Bass, and believe that as long as a condition of the sale is that we will have connectivity from the north to the south through the future development, that we would be willing to allow that property to be transferred. So if you agree in concept, we will continue pursuing down that path and get an agreement with Mr. Bass and Mr. Goodall to ensure that connectivity occurs, and then we will come back to you at the next meeting with a resolution that authorizes Eric to sign a letter informing the TDOT Excess Land Committee that we'll waive our right to purchase the property.
And I just want to be clear, this in no way commits the board to any approval of the development itself.
No.
It'll have to go through the normal development process and review, neighborhood meetings, all that stuff. This just helps them know what property they might be able to work with in proposing whatever they propose. So all you're doing is saying, we don't need it with this condition that access is provided through the property, and otherwise it goes through the normal development process.
But it seems like TDOT has to offer it to the city as their excess.
It's sort of almost like a right of first refusal.
Yeah, yeah.
That there's not a community need, and we're saying as long as they provide access, that meets the community need, and they can move forward with it.
Clarify access.
Yeah.
Access.
I'm sorry.
I mean,
access.
So what I'm saying is, if somebody's coming from the Elks Lodge going down Riverview.
No.
Are they theoretically, because they're going to provide access, instead of taking that curve and coming to the light, they're going to be able to go straight through that property in some capacity?
Yes.
Okay.
From north to south.
Because I'm
now,
trying
you might
to figure
remember
out.
Our zoning ordinance requires connectivity. We want to ensure that with the sale of this right-of-way or transfer of this right-of-way, it's a sale too, that we're going to ensure that connectivity through that future development of that property when it occurs.
That's good to do it on the front end.
Yes, it is. We've learned some lessons.
Alderman Peterson, then Alderman Berger.
Okay, well, you can see up at the top of it, it's connected to kind of the Riverside Drive. But if you look down at the bottom, doesn't look like it's going to connect to Oak Meadow, though. What's that situation?
It's a dead end right now.
That's a very good observation.
No, this is a dead end right here, but I mean down here.
That's not an accurate depiction of what will be provided.
Okay.
Actually, the property that is owned by Franklin and Holdings comes around Oakview Drive a little bit.
Actually, on the other side.
Yes.
Can you go up there and point that out? Show me what you're talking about right down there.
Down at the very southern tip.
Yeah. Yeah.
What I'm trying to say.
At the V.
Right.
Okay. So that's what you.
Yeah, but they also own the property.
Yeah,
if you're
right.
Going Oak Meadow to the left.
Right.
Opposite.
On the other side of the road, they own
yes.
that property
mm-hmm.
as well.
That's part of that old parcel.
Down there where the trees
are. And I want to emphasize what Eric said. You know, we're not approving any development. That needs to come through the development plan process. And they assured us they'll engage the neighbors and do what's best for that property.
And when they come through, I mean, it may not be right along the existing Riverside Road. It may be.
Oh, yeah.
It may be part of their road network that
right.
whatever is proposed there.
Yes.
Yeah, because remember you go to the back.
Getting out of order and out of hand here just a second. A lot
sorry,
of people
sorry.
Mumbling and grumbling,
okay, well,
and I don't know what they're talking about.
We don't either.
I'm going to recognize one person. That's Alderman Peterson. Following
thank
that,
you.
I'll recognize Alderman
okay.
Berger.
So you're saying that this is not an accurate depiction of where the TDOT right-of-way ends there, or what?
No, we have a survey that we've been provided. I wanted to provide an illustration that was just illustrative of where that right-of-way exists. It's close, but that's the sliver of land that eventually will be transferred. And of course, a survey will be used by TDOT to transfer that property.
Okay, so, but TDOT's right-of-way just stops right there at the end, at the bottom of the little red?
It is, how should I say, confusing at that intersection. But the good news is that they will be able to connect to Oak Meadow Drive. And
okay,
that's where the connectivity
the property,
is, at some
property,
some point
yeah.
through that property, yes.
Okay, I now have Alderman Berger.
Okay, so following up with Ann's, this is what I was talking about right there. So at where Home Depot is coming into Summerbee, is it?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
Summerbee.
So that road there, this is going to be later, if it gets developed, then we could require that connection there.
It's possible anywhere
but that
along
would be later.
Along the yes, when we come through with the development plan, that will be worked out with our team and the developer.
Okay, so when you're saying access, and you're saying connectivity here to go through the lot, the entire acreage, that they're not committed, but we could also request, we could also make sure that happens at a later date, that that connects through Home Depot, between Home Depot and Summerby. But that's not part of this right now.
Not right now, no.
And it's not really a regulation road at the moment.
Right.
Oh, is it?
Not at all.
No, you're right. Because I, you know, the thing is, we fall back on a lot of times is our connectivity. And I just see that as critical, and maybe that road needs to be improved.
All I can say to is reinforce what our zoning ordinance says is that connectivity is required between adjacent parcels. And how that looks will come definitely during the development plan review process and planning.
I mean, I'm good with it. I just think we need to keep our eye on that part.
Okay, any other questions, comments? I get everybody recognized, so we'll move on to item 17, which is a discussion regarding design scenarios and survey results for the city-owned Hill property located at 403 and 405 Fifth Avenue North. I've got a number of speaker cards, and we're going to hold those till the last. But I do want to emphasize that if you can tonight decide on what you think the land use is housing the best choice in your mind, and is that some direction we give staff? If there is housing is a choice, then it's going to require a land use plan amendment. It's my understanding that the process likely would go into the fall of this year. And then lastly, we have a building that continues to deteriorate, and there's some feeling on staff's part that that building needs to go ahead and be demolished. So those are three things, and I hope y'all will reemphasize them again. And Eric, do you have anything else to add?
Just a couple words of introduction. We've got our staff team here, but yeah, this is. There's been a good amount of public dialogue for some time, and some structure that we put on it earlier this year, leading into tonight in terms of a public meeting and online survey that was provided to the public. Great response both to the meeting and to the online survey. We're going to share those results with you tonight. We also just want to talk generally about the design concepts that we put out there, at least in terms of things for people to react to and look at, and get your guidance, as the mayor shared. And the memo has sort of three key questions in it. What land use would BOMA like to see on the Hill property? We obviously have an existing land use plan, and that has a certain concept included in it. Is that good, or do you want to see us change it? Would BOMA like staff to move forward with an envisioned Franklin land or plan amendment reflecting one of those scenarios or some other scenario other than what is in place now? And then a more short-term or immediate question, and the board had weighed in on this a while ago, but we did revisit it some in terms of demolishing existing buildings on the site and sort of clearing that out, and that has benefits both in terms of the condition of those buildings, the potential issues related to that, and also helping you see that property without structures on it. Might give you a new view of it as well. So I'll let Emily and Kelly walk through some of this with you, and we'll do the presentation, take your questions, and we know we have a number of folks from the public here as well.
We're actually going to turn it over to our representative Josh from Tuck Hinton Architects, who's helped us with this study, and he's going to run through some of the design scenarios as well as some of the survey results. So I'll just go ahead and turn it over to him.
Hi. Yeah. My name is Josh Hughes. I'm with Tuck Hinton Architects. And first, let me thank the City of Franklin for involving us in this study. We've really enjoyed working with the planning staff, other city staff members, hearing from residents and other housing groups around town. Forgive me if this presentation, I might be in good company tonight, but if this presentation is a little bit dry, I'm trying to wear my independent consultant hat tonight and walk through each design concept.
Just talk into the microphone, please.
Sure.
Thank you.
So trying to present each concept in a neutral light, assume this is on, right? Okay. So if we could bring up the maybe the existing conditions boards first, is that possible? I know we have the fly-throughs to walk through, and I don't want to be sensitive to your time tonight, too, but just want to hit all the key points.
I think it's the last.
And I could talk. I can go ahead and start talking through some of this. But the existing site is 5 1/4 acres. You guys know where it is. Border on the north side by Del Rio, and mostly commercial uses to the north. Directly to the west, we've got two cemeteries, one of which is a National Historic Landmark site. And then to the south, most primarily residential use, most notably the Hard Bargain neighborhood. And then directly to the east, you have Hillsborough Road and Bicentennial Park. Main reason I mention this is just that it's surrounded by multiple land uses. I think argument could be made, again, for each and any of these concepts that I'm walking you through tonight. There are several challenges with developing the site, the irregular shape of it. You have a 75-foot landscape buffer that's required to the west, due to the, again, the historic landmark site, the Toussaint Cemetery. It's elevated adjacent to Hillsborough Road, which makes it not very vehicular, not friendly to vehicles or pedestrians. And then in addition to that, the only current site access would be through the intersection of 3rd Avenue. So that is in the 100-year floodplain. So again, some emergency access in the event of a flood would be another consideration for weighing in these three concepts. Again, just to reiterate, these are concepts. They're not 100% vetted, but really just trying to convey and help you visualize what the possibilities would come with each of the three uses. And from there, I think we can jump into the each of the concept boards. And then, so I'd like to walk through the recreational concept, jump into the fly-through, and repeat for the next two. So the recreational concept first, we looked at it. Obviously, it's compatible with the current use. We looked at it more with its adjacency to Bicentennial Park. What would most complement what's already there and planned for Bicentennial Park? So what we came up with was more programmed activities, parking, and more restroom or changing facilities. And so you'll see what we're showing here proposes keeping the existing metal building, opening it up, having it become more of a covered shelter for smaller courts, things like basketball, potentially bocce ball, shuffleboard, and then towards the south end of that building, you have an enclosed structure for restrooms, changing facilities, possibly equipment rental. And then out front of that, you have a flat area of site that could be used for intramural activities. And then down to the south, additional parking with a proposed connection directly to Bicentennial Park via pedestrian bridge. And that could also provide an opportunity for the city to provide more of an image or a gateway entering into the north end of the downtown district. And then you'll see consistently between the three options, we're showing this lower area at the very south edge of the site that is in the floodplain. So we think that would best be used in all three of them as a recreational use. Here we're showing a children's play area or playground, which I'm sure would be welcomed by all those who frequent Sonic. And from there, we can run into the fly-through. Each of these videos is about a minute and a half. I'm not going to try to fill that up with talking, but I can kind of give you some cues as to where we're starting and as we're, yeah. So here we're starting at the Del Rio intersection, traveling south towards 3rd Avenue. Traveling along the retaining wall, this part will get a little bit monotonous.
Takes a long time to get there. In all three scenarios.
Yes.
That's what it's like when you go to the speed limit.
Trying to get a point across.
Very funny.
I was totally unfamiliar with it, too. So.
So here you have the children's play area down in the lower area, and then as you travel up into the site, immediately surface parking. And you're seeing the existing metal building there with the restroom structure, and you're traveling around this intramural field that could be used for, you know, I think it's more for public use, not for children's sports programs or anything like that. And then you're entering underneath the existing metal building. It's open on all sides, open air, traveling through the covered courts, looking at the restroom facilities and potentially equipment rental. And then again, looking towards the pedestrian bridge as we back out of the site. So now if we can travel back to the boards, and feel free to interrupt me with any questions if I'm moving too quickly or too slowly.
That metal building that you showed?
Yes.
So what is that supposed to be doing there?
That's the building that's currently on the site that you guys are, I think, looking for more input on.
Oh,
yeah.
So it's just there to give the place, to place set it for our benefit, but we don't know what's happening.
Covered with the basketball court, right?
Correct. Yeah, so you would have.
I didn't know that.
It would stay as a covered, cover the basketball court. You can play when it's raining.
Covered
right.
Basketball court?
And bocce ball, he said
bocce
earlier.
Ball. Okay.
Yeah, this is just some ideas for what could go underneath it.
Okay.
Yeah.
I just wanted to see what you had.
We saved the old building now, the tube plant down there.
Mm, that's right.
That's right. Yeah, it's not.
So it's not an unsimilar mm-hmm. concept.
That's right.
If that's what we're looking for that particular piece of
that's
property.
That's right. And so. I've seen it done in multiple other areas outside of Franklin. I think it's usually pretty successful in that people are able to use those facilities, you know, in all weather types. So I can jump right into the compact housing scheme. Maybe start with the board again, but maybe not. So while we're passing the retaining wall, I can talk through it. But we based this.
Do you want to go to the boards or do you want to go to the video? How would you like?
I think the boards are easy to start with, so you can get a sense of the context before we dive into the videos. That scheme. So. We looked at this as R6 type zoning, which would be most consistent with hard bargain to the south. We were able to comfortably fit 16 units here. You can see they're all organized around a looping drive. They're all approximately 1 to 1.5 stories, 1,000 to 1,500 square foot homes. They all have each a minimum lot size of 4,000 square feet, and then you have additional open space around the perimeter. You can see this was affected by the shape of the site in addition to that dark green shaded area, which was the 75-foot setback for the Toussaint Cemetery. I think we go ahead and I can keep talking. Go ahead and jump into the fly-through video.
What's the square foot of that proposed housing?
The housing as shown is 1,000 to 1,500 square feet. And the design for the houses, what you'll see in here is consistent with what would be required by the historic design guidelines for infill developments. So again, painful retaining wall looping into the site.
So driving along that retaining wall, could we see anything? I mean, according to that little drive, see anything.
Yeah, these are set back.
Okay.
A significant distance from that wall, so there's not, other than starting at Del Rio, you're not really getting many views of the structures on the site. The architecture of these.
I didn't see Sonic either.
It was gray.
It was gray. It was down there. It was there.
Yeah. If they want us to put it in.
We can start back at the beginning of the video.
Okay.
But you know, the architecture again is a placeholder for what would be consistent with the historic design guidelines. If you want to go back quickly to the beginning, we don't have to watch the whole video again. But
do you want to go back 30 seconds or so? Take them back through the residential a little bit. We're,
whoa.
Yeah, that's good. Right there.
Yeah.
Sonic's there, Clyde, I promise.
Is that the back end of the property?
Yeah, to the left there is the cemetery.
Where's the very back end of the property? Right up here? Where we're going past next?
When you're saying back end, are you saying the cemeteries?
Yeah, those. Furthest away.
Those are directly ahead right now.
Furthest away from the road.
To the right now.
Right to the right?
Yes.
So these homes up here would be the furthest away from the road?
Correct.
Yes.
I'm just curious when we're looking at this, if you put townhomes in the back part, two-story, on that back part, you're driving down, you see that wall, and then you've got trees. Can you go back to that last part? I'm not sure you can. But as you're driving down Hillsboro right now, when you're way up, you can see, but at the same time, you've got that wall, see?
So you don't. So this is the beginning view where you can see.
You'll see those the houses.
Not when you've got big trees. You've got 100, 200 feet trees.
We don't have big trees.
Well, they do grow, Margaret. I'm not talking about today. I'm talking about, now, what I'm really curious about, though, because I actually bring this up because Alderman Martin brought this up, and it was one of her concerns, and it's also a concern of mine.
There's Sonny.
When you're driving, when you're driving down there, what you could see, because, in my opinion, the houses, if we do utilize it for houses, I would think towards the very back part, you would want to put townhomes, single families up front, townhomes in the back, so you have more residents and utilize the property better. And then one of her concerns was that, you know, as you drive down, what do you see? Well, with the wall there and everything else, but you're going to put trees that are going to grow hundreds of feet high, hopefully, someday.
Yeah.
And eventually fill that in.
And Kelly, you might be able to talk more to it, but our third scheme is mixed residential, which I think could become that.
Yeah.
I'm
okay.
Just not
let's
sure
lo- right.
logistics
okay.
of
all right.
single family homes and attached units on the same property
okay.
and how specific that gets.
Okay. Yeah, these three scenarios didn't really consider a mix of the two. We wanted to kind of show you a more dense intensity rather with the third option that you're about to see, and then kind of see the single family. But under the mixed residential design concept, you could have a mixture of both single family and townhomes. That would totally be within the parameters of that design concept. We just didn't, you know, have six different design scenarios to work with here.
Sure.
So we were kind of limited.
I understand that. It's fine.
Sorry.
That's fine.
So I think, and now we can jump to the third concept, which we're already on. Okay. So here you can see the development's organized kind of in the same, I mean, there's only so many circulation patterns you can establish on the site that work. Here we still have the same looping drive. The buildings are organized around that drive, but here you have instead of a kind of perimeter green space, you have a shared green space at the center of the community. The units themselves are a mix of townhomes, duplexes, big houses, or what some might call flats. They're all 1.5, two-story buildings. The units themselves would range from 800 to 1,500 square feet. I think it would be important to note on here that we would be required to provide two-sided or four-sided architecture. The architectural detailing that you would see from the inside of the community would also be required on the outside facing Hillsboro Road or the perimeter of the site. So you can jump into the video again. We can experience that retaining wall.
How many units did you say?
Units, 37.
So 16 residential versus 37.
16 for the first.
Correct.
Okay,
so here's the view into the site as as we approach the retaining wall. There's placed a big house unit there at the corner to anchor that. And then you can see we've also place some landscaping up there. So there, if the landscaping was not mature, yes, you might you would catch some views of the housing units. Again, this part of the fly-through is consistent throughout the three schemes, and then again, you've got another big house unit anchoring the corner here. You can see the central green space in the center and lined around the perimeter with the townhomes. Again, the architectural language would be consistent, similar styles of architecture between this and the compact housing. I think from there, I'd be happy to walk you through any of the more of the nuances in between the schemes if you have specific questions.
Alderman Prancer.
So for conversation purposes, to back to Alderman was mentioning a mixture. Mm-hmm. We could perhaps get 20-25 if you had a mixture of condo and single family.
That could be possible, yeah.
Okay, so certainly. We could increase the number by and have a mixture of single family individual homes as well as the, mm-hmm. yeah. So that
right, and would that be consistent with an SDR zoning or?
We're really looking at envision Franklin at this point, and the mixed residential design concept is the one that we used for this third approach, and it does allow single family as a primary building type there.
And there was 37 in it.
In mixed residential, 37. In the single family compact residential, 14.
16. But what limited that was the minimum lot size of 4,000 square feet once you start placing those blocks on the site and trying to keep a complete vehicular circulation path through the site. It really limits it.
Were all the parking in front of the units, or were there extra parking along the street or something?
On both of those, we had some
visitor
parking as you entered the site, kind of
in this area of the site here.
Mm-hmm. And there was no other parking on the public roads.
And emergency vehicles could easily, well, maybe not easily, but could access the property.
Yes.
In either scenario, could
navigate
either housing scenario.
Yes.
Okay. Except during a flood event.
Yes.
Oh, good flood. Point. We have to thank go by boat.
The primary access into the site is in the 100-year floodplain. So emergency access, as Josh mentioned earlier, is something to consider with any residential development on this property.
So where would you put that?
So perhaps something off of Mount Hope, maybe accessing through somebody's office.
Creative solutions would have to be explored.
Yeah.
Okay. That's a concept we have heard in some other discussions is that you might need an emergency access from the south.
Mount Hope.
From the south?
Yeah, through the neighborhood.
Oh, back?
Yeah.
Back on the other
side. Yeah, it's kind of southwest, I guess.
Yeah. Well, y'all are struggling to ask your questions and decide what you want to ask. Could I ask a question?
Yeah. Certainly.
Because that first scenario with the parking and programmed activities, I'm sorry, but that building doesn't look like anything even that I've seen. I mean, did y'all do some analysis of that building?
Yeah.
Or did y'all just kind of sketch in some big steel beams and things?
Well, we did walk through the building. I believe it's a prefab metal building, so those major structural elements would look similar to that. It would be removing all the cladding. You might have to put a new roof on it. But most of the work would be demolishing, selective demolition. I think, again, there are other areas in Frank. It looks like a very sturdy building to me. I know that there's a lot of code violations associated with it that would prevent it from being utilized as a public building, but if it's just an outdoor structure, I think it's a very viable.
Was there any possibility of pedestrian bridge with the residential?
There's not any reason why that couldn't happen. I think it would just, it would be more of a pub, I would assume it would be more of a public investment versus a, with the housing, those would be probably, I would assume would be primarily funded by either a private entity or nonprofit. I don't know if they would be interested in providing the pedestrian bridge.
Yeah, okay, just want to put it out there.
Mayor.
Go ahead, Alderman Vaughn.
Two or three things, I guess. Number one, the where the transfer station is now, you've got a playground there. And I guess I've overlooked at some point in time the some of the drawings and whatever. But I've always sort of envisioned that as being parking for the Bicentennial Park overflow and a parking issue that we've got here in Franklin. I've never really envisioned that as being a playground for either the any of the four concepts that you've given. Now, it can be a playground, I'm sure, but have you looked at parking? I mean, that's...
Parking would be allowed, I would say. We didn't explore that necessarily because there are certain open space requirements, formal open space requirements with any residential development especially. And given the constraints on the site, that corner may be the only possible location for the formal open space. So that's why that was kind of explored in this situation. Parking could definitely be something that could go at the corner. From a planning perspective, we would recommend highly screening that parking lot since it is a very visible intersection. And our zoning ordinance would definitely back us.
Well,
in that.
Trees grow fast in Franklin.
That's what I hear. You know, some type of gateway element like a wall or something like that could help as well.
Well, I just know that we struggle with parking and parking issues, and we've struggled with 600 open space parking spaces and how we're going to do 2-hour, 4-hour parking and all that. So I'm just looking at that. That's not an unrealistic walking distance from downtown Franklin or the Bicentennial Park or any other area. So I was looking at that more for parking than I was to have a playground there that's possibly going to be used a small portion of the time or whatever it is. And you've got the Bicentennial Park on the other side of the road. So that being said, this is going into it. I've said for eons now, months now, those old buildings need to be torn down. That transfer station needs to be the first thing that needs to be torn down. And the first concept for there's a park there is not my vision. I may be getting ahead of where we need to be on the presentation. You can continue on at some point in time. But we need to really look at this solving problems more so than just the housing shortage and some of the things that we'll look at here tonight. So that's what I was looking at from that particular standpoint.
The recreation design concept would lend itself more to having amounts of parking on the site. I would say that.
The hill.
Right. Any of the design concepts could have parking in the lower area. These examples are illustrative of what the design concepts might allow, but this is really to help steer what the actual land use desired by the board would be. And so we could proceed forward with an Envision Franklin amendment. The actual designs, they're flexible. Okay. Parts can be eliminated or added as needed, depending on which design concept in Envision Franklin is chosen.
Alderman Speedy?
Maybe Lisa could help us on this one. I know we're doing like a joint venture with FSSD schools, and I mean, probably literally 200 yards away is all that land across from Johnson and Freedom, and aren't we already kind of doing some parks and fields and walking trails?
We've done some concept planning around those spaces. In fact, at this week, this month's Capital Investment Committee, we're going to talk a little bit about our first phase. That centers more on the athletic fields at the Freedom Middle and Poplar Grove complex, but we have plans, you know, concept plans for what can happen at the Johnson Freedom Intermediate site and the Glass Lane, just open field there. So that's, yeah, that's not too far away, and that's something that you can look at in terms of connection and how the space might work together.
Alderman Peterson.
Well, since it was mentioned about parking, you know, we have apparently the same number of parking places as we have people who actually work downtown. And so trying to find a location where there could be parking and perhaps even parking with kind of a shuttle to get, you know, down to Main Street and everything. And whenever you mentioned that about parking, I was really thinking of more than just something for Bicentennial Park.
Well, I mean, I should, well, I don't put words like
no,
that, because
no,
I mean
no.
The parking is there 24/7. It's not just Bicentennial parking. Yeah, I never intended it to be tied to that. It's close to the park.
I've been reminded we have kind of a
okay.
I'm ready.
Survey results.
Yes,
so,
yes, thank
you. We can
you.
Go to that.
Annette, one of our land planners in the planning department, is going to walk you through the survey results pretty briefly here. We have separated some of them out in your attachments for you, because there were quite a bit of difference between the online results and the ones that were received at the neighborhood meeting. And then we've compiled the responses together as well, so you can see how it all accounts. But we thought, given the distinct differences, it might be good to see them separately
Thank
as well.
Thank you. That was it.
Annette Whitehurst, I'm a land planner here at the city. I am going to go over the public outreach from the neighborhood meeting and the online survey results. The Hill Property Survey was designed around three scenarios that Josh just presented: the recreation, compact residential, and the mixed residential. The goal of the survey was to get feedback on the public's preferred land use choice. And an open-ended question was posed to give the respondent the chance to write in their own scenario, option, or vision. The surveys were distributed in paper form, and they were distributed online. The neighborhood meeting was held on February 15th. We had about 101 people in attendance, and paper surveys were distributed, and we received 80 of those surveys back. And I'm going to go over the neighborhood survey results first before going over the online survey results. For this question, what is your overall vision for the Hill property? Compact single family and the other choice both had 57% of the vote. The other option allowed for you to write in a comment. And there were 42 responses, with the majority writing in workforce or affordable housing. Go to the next slide. The second question, they were asked to rate the compact residential design concept. One was for strongly disapprove, and 10 was strongly approve. The weighted average here was 7.8 with a strong approval. For the mixed residential design concept, the weighted average was 6.9. slightly lower, but still with a strong approval. And then onto the recreation design concept, the average was 2.6 with a disapproval. For the next question, if you prefer the recreational design concept, which types of recreational amenities would you like? This was an open-ended question. Several people wrote in the type of park or open space they would like to see. And some wrote in no or NA. They just were not in favor of recreation. The next question was, which type of housing would you prefer? There were three choices: single family, townhomes, and the big house option. A and B, both single family and townhomes, received votes in the 60th percentile. And there was a question, the median home value is $459,000,
Would you like to see a range of housing prices? Yes received 80% of the votes, and of the 12 no responses, 7 of these wanted not a range, but all lower priced homes. If you prefer another use, what would you like to see? The majority had 5 votes with affordable or workforce housing. And then the final one, do you live in Franklin? Yes, received about 93% of the vote. The online survey reached a much broader audience than the neighborhood meeting, which was more of a targeted audience. You will notice that these responses differ from those of the neighborhood meeting. The same survey was compiled into SurveyMonkey and was distributed online through email. We sent out over 700 emails, and it was also distributed online through Facebook and our other social media, and also mentioned on TV. We received 1,571 responses. Can you go back to the previous slide, please? Okay. The first question again, what is your overall vision? Recreation and open spaces received 65% of the response with over 1,000 votes. There were 182 written comments for the orange area, which is other, and the top 2 responses were recreation and open space or affordable housing. Next slide. On the scale question for compact residential again, with 1 being the strong disapproval and 10 being the strong approval, the weighted average here was 3.2 for a strong disapproval. For the mixed residential, the weighted average was 3.0, also strong disapproval. And then for the recreation, the weighted average was 7.4 for strong approval. For the question on what recreational amenities would you like to see, a text analysis was done of the responses. The bold and bigger answers received the most comments. Those are basketball courts, playgrounds, park, walking trails, and walking paths. What type of residential use would you like to see? None of the above received the most responses with 50%. And then came in single family came in second with 33%. For the range of housing prices, no received the most votes with 52%, and yes received 47%. There were a total, there were a total of 715 no responses. 669 of those no's would like no housing at all, but would be okay with recreation or civic space. 21 of those no's would not like a range of housing prices, but would like single family homes or townhomes. 20 of those no's would not like a range, but would like all lower priced homes. And 5 of those no's would not like a range, but would like all higher priced homes. If you prefer another use, what would you like to see? We received 414 written comments, and the number one response with 141 votes, people wrote in Franktown or nonprofit. In second place, 133 votes, park and recreational uses or open space. And then the final question, do you live in Franklin? Yes, received the same amount as the paper survey with 93%. And then if you compare the neighborhood meeting results to the online survey results, the neighborhood meeting respondents wanted compact single family and workforce or affordable housing, and the online respondents wanted recreation and open space. For the range of housing prices, the neighborhood meeting respondents were in favor of the range and 93%. And for the online respondents, they did not favor a range of housing prices at 54%. Next slide. If you combine the two surveys, no answer on the online survey results wavers to any different answer. Recreation still has the highest number. The question about the range of housing prices, the yes and no gap slightly decreased down to 2%. And the top written comment still remains as Franktown and nonprofit. Moving forward, the existing design concept for the Hill property is recreation. If the recreation land use is chosen, Envision frankly would not need to be amended, but if you chose one of the housing options, it would need to be amended. So I have three questions that we would like direction on. What land use would you like to see for the Hill property? Two is, would you like staff to move forward with an Envision Franklin plan amendment for one of these scenarios? And three, would you like to move forward with the demo of the existing buildings?
I want to see if the board wants to make any other comments. A lot of material.
Yes, there is.
I think my question would be, did Franktown line up everybody that's ever heard of Franktown? Have them fill out the survey? Mm-hmm. Seems a little skewed there, but appreciate their enthusiasm.
I have a question. The online survey, strictly online, do we know where these surveys or these answers came from? Within the city limits? Do we have that ability through that? Or do we require their zip code or their address?
No, we just,
could they be
just
from
offered the question, do you live in
Pango Pango or
yeah.
Thailand or California or Nashville?
I mean, 93% of the people that responded said that they were in Franklin. So.
So what, it was one survey response per device. It did provide that
right.
control.
I know.
So
I took it online.
Yeah.
Okay.
So you're saying the combined paper and online, the determination was what? Because that was the next last slide.
Still recreation and open space if you
combine
the two.
Okay. I'll go ahead and say I've kind of said it for the last 7 years. I think we've done a great job of talking about affordable housing, and I hate to use that word. We've done a great job of putting a lot of work behind solving a problem. And I think for me, this presents an opportunity to finally do something tangible about a problem that we face. My hope is. And it's funny when you get to these meetings because you feel like you talk and talk and it's like you feel like you're being redundant. So to those I'm being redundant, I apologize. The other thing that's encouraging to me about the proposed use of housing, it's like calling somebody an alleged whatever, is that a prior meeting, knowing that we have some nonprofits whose focus is this initiative, who are willing to come to the table together. It's not about who did it first. It's not about who does it better or who does it cheaper. It's about combining efforts for them to produce something that, again, will address a very serious issue that we have talked about for a long time. So I understand visuals and gateways, and it's funny how that gateway has moved all the time. I can remember Ernie Bacon saying the benchmark to the gateway of Franklin is Gateway Village. We've got this beautiful stone wall at Mac Hatcher that's a gateway. And so it's like, how do you define the gateway? You know, I think we have several different opportunities where we can make people go, Franklin. If you consider the long drive on the video on Del Rio, after that wall, the first thing you see is Sonic Drive-In. No offense.
Yeah.
It's not the Sistine Chapel. The other thing that I would tell you is before you. But the other thing that I would tell you is if it's an eyesore to have housing up there, what's there is a horrible eyesore.
Yeah.
The other thing I could tell you is if we demolish that building, and I'm not saying I would love for Franktown to be able to use it in the interim if that works out safely. I have no problem with that. But as you approach Del Rio, if that building were to be gone, as far as a view shed, an embarrassing visual, there is a historic cemetery that will never go away, that honors our fallen African-American people, citizens. This community and citizens, whether they were veterans or not. So some people may look at that as an eyesore. But then directly across the street, beyond Bicentennial, we celebrate another cemetery. So as far as it being, oh, this is going to be horrible to look at, Margaret, I love you, but I disagree with that. My hope is, and I'm fixing to stop, my hope is that if we are able to build consensus to do something tangible, finally, even if it's, and I don't have a problem whether it's 16 single family or compact, if we can do something successful that provides walkability to school, to Kroger, to jobs, to recreation, to transit, to all of these things, I think that we're going to have a much better opportunity down the road to have a public-private partnership for someone to go, that worked, and I'm willing to donate my land to let it work again over here. So I apologize for those of you who think recreation is the use. It has been a part of my gut for decades that this is something that I would like to see happen. So I advocate for housing.
Alderman Burton.
Randy, ditto, ditto, ditto. I don't want to be redundant either, but everything you said, I believe everything you said I agree with. Unless I missed something. but I want the best and highest use for this property. Of course, workforce housing is a need. We do need to do everything we can to promote that. I'm a free market person, and I want to see free market totally come into play here. But at the same time, we have an opportunity with this property to give it the best and highest use. And I would not be in favor of doing single-family homes up there only. I think, and you come down Hillsborough, I want to be sensitive to all these issues, especially Margaret's issue, and I think that that has a lot of merit, that you have to be careful what's there. As you said, Sonic is not the Sistine Chapel. It's the wall is there. It's been, Hillsborough has been made to look so much better and beautiful, and we have so many comments all the time of how wonderful that road and landscaping and everything turned out. So I think we need to really look at some of these comments that were made tonight. Clyde brought up some great points about parking. I initially thought, wait a minute, we've got some areas over for Bicentennial Park and how that develops out nearby at the school. The other thing that puts a playground right by the road, right down near the road, don't think it's an appropriate area for a playground as much as it would be for parking. And you could screen it, you could put a lot of landscaping up there and make it look nice so we don't come down and just see cars. And I think as you come into Hillsborough Road, we have a tree bank, for heaven's sakes. Let's use the tree bank and let's put up some large trees. Don't put in little squatty trees, let's put up larger trees and get them going if we have housing up there so that we can have a lush area that look like on these drive-thrus. There are a lot of trees in that area. So I think there's a lot of things can be done. The parking use, the tree bank, to get a lot of landscaping in there. But the back part of that property, I think, needs to be used for townhomes. I think they need to be two-story townhomes, two levels if we can. Push back towards the back so they're not up front by the road, and get better, the highest and best use of that property. If we're going to do housing, let's do it. Let's get the highest use we can. So in recreation, I just don't think it's appropriate for that area because we have a lot of other options in the area, and as Bicentennial gets developed, we just need to look elsewhere for those for recreation. The only other thing I would say is I have an issue when you get locked into workforce housing and you don't allow people to build equity in their homes. Being a free market person, I'm not in favor of restricting that. We take a risk, you know, with that, but somewhere there's going to be a cap. Somewhere our housing prices have got to level out. So I think we ought to be able to build whoever buys those homes and those townhomes or homes, whatever would be put there, they have to be able to have the ability to build equity in their property. So those were my points, and I believe a lot of things I heard from Brandy and Clyde certainly agree with.
Alderman Barnhill, and then we're going to try to allocate a few minutes
for
public comments.
Very brief. I'm not for the park concept, okay? And I'm not for the park down where I think there should be parking. And I think for us to go in tonight, this grand plan of what that size house needs to be, this size house needs to be, that's not what we're here for. I think what we're here for is to understand what we envision there. It doesn't have to be a specific house size in my mind tonight. It doesn't have to be a specific price. It can be designed to a specific need, but not necessarily have the specifics that we've gotten into tonight. But I don't think I've made a secret out of tearing those buildings down, tearing the transfer station down. I've said this for 2 or 3 years now. Let's go get them. They are not going to be used, and I don't think they'd be appropriate in the condition that they're in to be used by Franktown for any length of time, and to put in what we would have to put into it for them to get anything out of it. So we can look someplace else. That's another project, another set of circumstances. But if we're going to do this, and I will put this caveat up for myself, I'm probably not going to give the property away. Okay? Now, I may be the only one on the board that does want to give it away. I'm not going to give a $2.6 or $7 million piece of property appraised away. So when we start looking at these things and the people who come forth with the plans themselves, they need to understand there's going to be at least 1/8 resistance there onto that. There'll be other areas and other ways we can help, but it won't be to just completely, totally give it away. So you can use that.
Mr. Mayor, I have just one thing to say, and that is about the entrance being in the floodplain. I have a great concern about having any kind of residential, and I've been against any kind of residential planned on the other side because that part is in the floodplain, and I do not like the idea of
so
that.
Is that a no? I'm trying to count here. Is that a no?
Uh-huh. Well, it would. I mean, there might be some possibilities of making an entrance somewhere else, but honestly, but I can tell you, no. If that is the entrance, I would have to say no.
Perhaps one idea is if the board would like us to go in the direction of the mixed residential design concept, which is what I think I'm hearing mainly in majority, anyways.
Well, half.
Half. We could add a special consideration that addresses certain elements for this particular property, such as any development should have a secondary access that is located outside of the 100-year floodplain. It will present challenges in the design, of course, and whoever the developer would be at some point in time would have to creatively solve that issue. But that is something we can write as a special consideration and envision, Franklin, for safety purposes.
Absolutely, I think for safety you do not want.
I thought I heard you say that earlier.
Yes, that's something that can be looked at. Yes.
But it's not.
It's not an easy solution.
Exactly.
Alderman Speedy.
Sure. While I'd hate to ever vote against basketball courts, I do agree.
Listen, if you miss the goal, that ball's going wild.
That's true. But I like the higher density mixed residential design. Echoing what Alderman Barnhill said, and that is a valuable piece of property, so I'd like to see it the highest and best use of that land.
Well, I do have a few speaker cards, but I'm going to respectfully ask those speaker cards that there will be another opportunity to speak if the board doesn't object, and I think they've heard the board speak tonight, and we have to turn the room over for the next meeting. So is that okay with the board? Is that okay with the people who gave me the cards?
Can we limit their time to a minute and a half?
All right, I'm going to give everybody 30 seconds. Lillian Stewart.
How about a minute? We're trying to get people up here. Just make a comment.
Right, yes, ma'am. Wherever you want to be.
Your name and make a quick comment.
Why don't they line up so they can be there?
Dan, if you plan on speaking and you give me a speaker's card, please line up. I'm not accepting any more speaker cards either.
Lillian Stewart, I live at 201 Lewisburg Avenue. Lived here many, many years, and I know what you're struggling with. I think that the recreation is not appropriate here because that contributes, I think, partly to the price of the escalating price of houses. That's one more amenity. And I think, although it's wonderful to have, I think we're down to basics here, and the affordable housing issue is so very critical that this particular property fits that pattern that you read about so perfectly that I hope that will be considered tonight.
Thank you. Next. Brent Biscay.
As I've shared before, this parcel is located in Hard Bargain. For those who have grown up here, we have some multi-generational Hard Bargain residents that have been living here in this community for generations. And we are very mindful of that. In addition, I wanted just to address a couple of the issues about the cemetery that the schematics show a significant buffer. So you're not going to be looking directly into homes there. There's going to be landscaping. And the other thing is that if not now, then when? This is a critical, perfect opportunity, as close to perfect as you can get, with the location, transportation. Children can, if people have opportunities, they can go to recreate, they can go to eat, they can go to work, all these types of things. And if we don't address this, the problem is only getting worse. Thank you.
Chris Barnhill.
I've been here before asking to use the property for nonprofit organizations such as Franktown to do our programming. Housing, of course, has been here asking. Of course, recreation, according to the survey, seemed to be the number one response. But I'm here to say it doesn't have to be an either or. It can be a both and. I've had several meetings with the Housing Coalition. We see no reason in the world why we can't work together. And at the top of the hill, have some affordable housing. Also have a facility there for Franktown. We have architectural renderings available, blueprints, schematics of what the outside would look like. We'd be happy to share with the aldermen. And while I understand parking is certainly important, I think those kids back there are more important. I think giving life skills and job skills, stopping the poverty in its tracks, changing a generation is one of the most important things we can do as a community. Franktown would like to do that. We could really use your help. Thanks.
Mr. Hall, did your daughter go home?
She had violin practice.
Okay.
Or lesson. My name is Thomas Hall. I live in Fieldstone Farm. So I just live right up Hillsboro, and I drive that stretch when I come down into Franklin. All three of the plans, I don't see any of them creating a view problem. I mean, I think the landscaping, I think most of us know that when you see a development go in, the development looks horrible. They don't have any, they scorched the earth to some extent, and they put landscaping in. 3 to 5 years later, you wouldn't have realized the change. So I think the view's gonna be great. I think we do need to deal with affordable housing, and I think this is a great opportunity. You guys as leadership, I mean, you look online, you had a plan in 2013, you had a plan in 2014, 2015. The state took some opportunity away from you by taking away inclusionary zoning financing. You've got to take some leadership, and I think this is a great opportunity for you to do it.
Ms. Patton.
I'm over from Hard Bargain, and we're in the need of affordable housing. And I'm going to bring this up back years ago. Throughout Franklin City, bought our property for $200 and $300 down on First Avenue, Church Street property. We didn't get no money for that property, but yet it's gone. So we need some affordable housing. I can go back and tell a whole lot of stuff about Frank.
Okay. thanks for those comments. And
I just want to make a comment. I think the young people, young youth that came out tonight to see the works of your public servants, thank you so very much for coming out. And if anybody wanted to say anything from that group, I will yield my time for you to make a comment. Does anybody want to say anything? Okay, maybe next time.
Okay, we'll see. It's about 10 after 7.
Yeah, I'll get it.